Just mark him yes.
Exactly. I bet he's not going to be here tonight.
You snooze, you lose.
Don't want him. Looks like. Looks like, yeah. Although he could still come in.
Is he here? Have you seen him?
I've not seen him.
I haven't seen him.
No, we're not going to have him.
Just mark him yes. For both.
Both. He'd like to dress up for both.
Trying to go, trying to win the prize money on the parade.
And he'll be bringing his pets.
He'll be riding something.
Anna signed it.
He'll be riding one of those bicycles with the big wheel.
should I mark him yes?
Okay.
Wangamander.
I was at this get together yesterday.
This is a notice of the 15th regular meeting of the 2010-2011 Common Council, and as is customary, our city clerk, Sue Richards, will read the quote of the evening.
Thank you, Mayor. Despite the immense challenges that we have faced and continue to face, we refuse to indulge in negativity or pessimism. We are an organization that believes in empowering people to be their best.
Thank you, Sue. Roll call, please.
Warren.
Here.
Bauk.
Here.
Bowers.
Here.
Decker.
Here.
Hammond.
Here.
Hannah.
Here.
Heidemann.
Here.
Pott.
Here.
Kittleson.
Here.
Montemayor.
Here.
Rindfleisch.
Here.
Raessler.
Here.
Sampson.
Here.
Vanderweel.
Here.
Versey.
Here.
And Wangamann.
Excused.
15 present.
We have a quorum. Now Alderman Decker will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Jeremy. Looking for approval of the minutes of the former Common Council meeting. President
Thank
Kittleson.
Thank you, Mayor. I would move to approve the minutes of the last Common Council meeting.
Second.
We have a motion and a second under discussion. There is none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Confirmation of Mayor's appointments. Attorney McLean.
Thank you, Your Honor. Honorable members of the Council, hereby submit the following appointments for your confirmation. For the Business Improvement District, David Hanneman, Paul Weaver, David Gass, and Tom Brickley, all terms expiring 9/13/2013. Eileen Simmons, Mike Miller, and Mary Christian, terms expiring 9/11/2011, signed by the mayor.
For a motion?
Move to approve the appointments.
Second.
We have a motion and a second under discussion. Alderman Hammond.
Mr. Mayor, I'm not sure if this is appropriate, but I'd like to vote on Mr. Gass separately. I would need to abstain from that vote.
Okay, or you can just abstain from
the entire, got it.
Rather than
fair enough.
Two votes.
Fair enough.
Okay, is there any further discussion? There is none. Roll call, please.
Warren.
Aye.
Bauk.
Aye.
Bowers.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
Hammond.
Abstain.
Hannah.
Abstain.
Heidemann.
Aye.
Kott.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Raessler.
Aye.
Sampson.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
And Versey.
Aye.
14 ayes, one abstention.
Two abstentions.
That's what I said. 13 ayes, two abstentions.
Motion carries. Other appointments, Attorney McLean.
Deputy Chief Chuck Butler to be considered for the Board of Electrical Examiners to fill the unexpired term of Chief Inspector Robert Cutsmode, which term expires April 23, 2013. Signed by the mayor.
Move to approve the appointment.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the appointment. Under discussion? If there is no discussion, roll call, please.
Bauk. Bowers.
Aye.
Decker.
Aye.
Hammond.
Aye.
Hanna.
Aye.
Heideman.
Aye.
Koth.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Raisler.
Aye.
Sampson.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Versi.
Aye.
Boren.
Aye.
Bauk.
Aye.
And Bowers.
Aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. Moves us on to, any other appointments? No other appointments? Moves us on to public forum. Sue?
Okay. Before we get going with the public forum, I just want to remind everybody, we do this when it's election time, whether it's candidates, anything that happens on the ballot for the election tomorrow. We just want to remind the people in the public forum that this is not a place where we allow any campaigning. We would ask that you refrain from campaigning, vote for so-and-so, vote for this, vote for that. Just keep to your comments and no campaigning, and that's what we would ask. Okay? First on the list is Jack Wirtz. Evening, Jack. Could we have your home address, please?
47 Winnebago Place.
47 Winnebago. And you will have 5 minutes, sir.
Mayor Ryan, members of the council, and citizens of Sheboygan. I recently had a flyer left at my home from the Firefighters Union. It contained a section called Unanswered Questions. That section raised some questions of my own about subsidy. For an example, in an auto accident where glass, gasoline, and antifreeze needs to be cleaned up, why is this a subsidy to a private ambulance? They surely cannot stay and clean up that debris. Isn't this one of the many jobs of the fire department? It has always been part of the duties performed by the fire department. And furthermore, I am not aware of a taxpayer subsidy to a private provider. If there is none, why does the union ask who pays for something that doesn't exist? Another question I have is, where in the referendum does it propose to cut the number of ambulances anywhere? Does the union have information that the public doesn't? The union asks if we're willing to put our lives in jeopardy due to layoffs. It is the job of any city department to do the best they can under any circumstances. Is the union saying they are unable to do so? I sure hope not. Such ambiguous questions only tend to confuse and frighten voters. All five stations could remain intact if the ambulance was once again returned to the private sector. Tomorrow in voting, think of the lyrics of an old song, as I will be doing. That is to accentuate the positive and eliminate the negative. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack.
Thank you, Jack. Next.
Next would be Dennis Tetchlog. Been a long time, Dennis. Can I have your home address, please?
Dennis Tetchlog, 3816 South 11th.
3816?
3816 South 11th.
All right, and you will have 5 minutes, sir.
Okay. Mayor, Council, Sheboygan residents, the remarks I'm going to make are relative to the ambulance referendum. First of all, I'm a taxpayer of Sheboygan, member of Sheboygan County Taxpayers Alliance. Alliance is your watchdog of the city government, with primary purpose to watch over our taxing demands. I was a council member in 1988 when this, which voted to remove the ambulance service from the police department and go to private provider. It had worked well for 20 years until the council was swayed to place the service in the fire department on the pretext of making money when real reason was employee protection. We were not paying for a service unless using it. We now pay 24/365. Due to our audit demands, which with a threat of legal action, we found there was a loss of income for 2009. As a council member up here for 25 years, my main concern was and still is to minimize tax increases. We must lower taxes. We will no longer require four added men in ambulances if the service is put back in private service, thereby saving over $400,000. There will not be any loss of services. The firefighters will go back to what they were doing prior to January 1st, 2008. Private provider presently has five ambulances for commitment, previously had seven when they were working privately. Chief is concerned about losing employees. Well, so did Orange Cross 3 years ago. Some of those same employees now work for the city fire department as paramedics. A paramedic has the same training, be it he or she, private or union member. We must start somewhere to cut costs, and there is room for a great deal of cost savings. The structure of the fire department is top-heavy with supervisory personnel, one supervisor for each 2.5 men. By the end of 2011, there will be 22 individuals, costing us taxpayers $100,000 each. You can save $2 to $3 million by removing sleepovers and go to shifts. Department is overstaffed, overpaid. Lots of money to be saved. A no vote will continue service as now.
Mr. Tishlock, we cannot speak of voting on any referendum questions. We cannot campaign.
All right. Why isn't the population in Sheboygan 200 or 250,000 people? The fire department and ambulance are not a primary concern of those people. Just ask the 32 fire department members that live outside of our city, pay no city taxes, free fire protection, and have Orange Cross as their ambulance provider. I would say we are subsidizing 32 firefighters at a cost of $2.5 million. Do not let fear and intimidation given by fire department sway you. Everything is the same as it was before December 31st, 2007. Future salary increases, we taxpayers have no control over. Possibility of losing six firefighters in 2011 will reduce services and make a private ambulance more viable. 451-9111 ambulance numbers remains on my refrigerator. Thank you.
Thank you, Dennis.
Thank you, Dennis. Next.
Next on the list is Dulcie Johnson. Dulcie, can I have your home address, please?
1306 North 3rd Street, Sheboygan.
North 3rd. And you will have 5 minutes.
Mayor Ryan, City Clerk Richards, City Attorney McLean, members of the council and citizens. After being told for weeks that the Schenck ambulance audit would not be available until after the November election, suddenly it was available on October 18th, 1 minute before the 5 p.m. deadline for information that was requested on September 30th. Per a Schenck CPA, the City Finance Department received the audit September 23rd or 24th. The audit shows that even using the marginal accounting analysis, the fire department ambulance business lost over $86,000 in 2009, which translates to $163,000 using a cash accounting analysis. Why was this information withheld? Throughout the six listening sessions, citizens and taxpayers were led to believe that the information was not available. It appears that those in attendance may have been deceived by the finance director, Mr. Amodio. If that proves to be the case, I believe Mr. Amodio should resign, and if Chief Herman was complicit in this, he should also resign. I attended the Finance Committee meeting last Monday. The executive budget cuts over $500,000 from Public Works, $300,000 from the library, and almost $250,000 from the police. It adds $10,000 to the fire department budget, but will still result in laying off six firemen. Chief Herman stated that he was moving ahead with closing a station with or without the ambulance. He indicated that he would probably close the downtown station, which has the most calls of any of the five stations. Mayor Ryan added that it is the most saleable property, which is obviously the number one criteria for closing a fire station, and that if the city retained the ambulance business, they would operate it for as much revenue as they can get, which would mean doing non-emergency transports to Milwaukee, Fond du Lac, and Green Bay. Chief Herman has often said that he needs Orange Cross as a backup, but then proceeds to take more business away from them. This is in keeping with his writing in 2007 when he said, "Maybe Orange Cross will still fold, and then we'll take over the entire Sheboygan area and hire 12 more firefighters." When asked how the department could do out-of-town transports with six layoffs, Chief Herman said that he can handle it with the current roster, which says loud and clear that the department is overstaffed. Out-of-town transports mean two firemen paramedics would be away from the city for up to 3 hours. I recall at the time of Sly's fire on 8th Street, Alderman Hanna, who at that time was chairman of Public Protection and Safety, said on the council floor that he would not approve of the department doing out-of-town transports because all the personnel were needed here. The department is doing non-emergency transports without council approval. The fire department cites a 22% success rate for cardiac arrest patients compared with only 6% for Sheboygan County. This is understandable given the need to travel across greater distances to provide health. What they do not mention, however, is that Orange Cross had a success rate of 26% when they provided service in 2007. It should be noted that all paramedics have the same training and continuing education requirements. As we have learned, the fire department ambulance business is very costly to the taxpayers. That should be no surprise, and as much as the police department lost $400,000 in 1988 when they operated roving ambulances while also acting as police officers. More recently, Mr. Amodio has said that the fire department ambulance business is probably not sustainable. This was demonstrated by former finance director Terry Hansen when he created his five scenarios. The scenario without the ambulance showed the smallest deficit. The city can staff all five stations without the ambulance, reduce personnel by six, and save over $450,000 in salaries and benefits from the fire department budget. The costs of a private service are borne only by those who use it. Department business, which is subsidized by the taxpayers. Government should not do what the private sector can do. I and another concerned citizen were out walking the neighborhood Saturday with information about the referendum. As we approached a house with a red and white sign, a man stepped out of the door and began asking questions related to the referendum issue. He obviously recognized me because at one point in the conversation, he asked if I was an alderman when the police ran the ambulance. I said I was. He asked the person with me for his name and in turn told us his name. He went on to say that he is a paramedic, that he had created the fire union referendum advertising campaign, and concluded by saying, and I quote, "We're going to kick your ass." That's been the tone of the fire union's campaign. Bullies on the playground, intimidating small business owners, going to homes of elderly citizens and frightening them. Case in point, firemen told a man in his late
80s. Excuse me, Dulcie, here, would you like your additional minute?
Please.
Move to approve.
Second.
Go ahead.
Going to homes of elderly citizens and frightening them. Case in point, firemen told a man in his late 80s that he had to vote for the fire department because if there was a fire at his house, they might not be able to put it out. City Attorney McLean was privy to part of that conversation. Fireman told another senior citizen that he had to take his black and yellow sign down or they'd be out of a job. Angry, desperate, childish. Their inappropriate behavior needs to be investigated by the Fire and Police Commission. Tomorrow, voters will have the opportunity to decide if the fire department should continue to operate an ambulance business or if it should be returned to a non-government entity. The choice should be easy. Let reason and common sense prevail. Thank you.
Thank you, Dulcie. Next on the list is Richard Hartman. Richard, can I have your home address, please?
2423 North 23rd Street, right here in Sheboygan.
Right, and you will have 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you. Citizens of Sheboygan and beyond, You might find what I have to say tonight a little bit different from what you've been hearing these past few weeks. It has to do with audits. Having satisfied an audit is of great significance to those undergoing one, and rightly so. For not only is anxiety relieved, the word audit itself has an authoritarian and unquestionable ring to it. Using the words by nationally recognized standards further reinforces any statements of certification. Or does it? Not too long ago, on August 14th to be exact, the Sheboygan Press printed a small news item that told of the Sheboygan Falls JC Bingo operation. The JCs had in place a bingo chairman whose duties were overseeing all aspects of the game, including bookkeeping and control of the bank account. Because bingo functions require a state license, they were subject to state audit. And the bingo chairman was the person to supply the state auditing board with the financials from these games. Here is where it gets a bit sticky. The bingo chairman was pilfering money from the proceeds collected, and in order to balance the books, he provided the state auditing board with adulterated figures. The outcome was that the state audit showed no problems, but that was because they were furnished with figures that could only show the wanted analysis. Other JC personnel were also keeping records, and upon their furnishing the state with the true figures, another state audit was conducted, and investigators found that $26,000 was unaccounted for. So much for the reliability of audits. An inordinate number of audits are not worth the paper they are written on unless they contain some sort of probe to the authenticity of records provided, especially when there has been a suggestion of deceptive reports. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard.
Thank you, Mr. Hartman. Next.
Last on the list would be Patricia Aholm. Patricia, can I have your home address, please?
2602A Camelot Boulevard.
All right, and you will have 5 minutes.
Thank you. Good evening. I would first like to thank those of you who have allowed the issue of ambulance service in the city of Sheboygan to be put to a referendum. This action has finally made it possible for the residents of the city of Sheboygan to express their viewpoint in regard to the unpopular way in which this service was taken away from Orange Cross Ambulance 3 years ago. In the past 5 months, I've appeared before this Common Council and its Public Protection and Safety Committee half a dozen times. I have no political aspirations or affiliations and never anticipated doing any public speaking. However, I became so incensed when the city's hiring freeze was lifted on June 21st by the mayor's tie-breaking vote to hire 4 additional firefighters that I could no longer continue to just sit back and take it. Like many honest, hardworking citizens of this city, I spent my entire life here working for small private businesses and raising 2 children as a single mom. Throughout my 44 and a half years of employment, my top salary was $12.50 an hour with no pension or retirement benefits. I received no public assistance of any kind during all that time, but I helped pay through real estate taxes, the high wages, overly generous benefits, and exorbitant pensions of the municipal employees that enjoyed high-end lifestyles and carefree retirement years. Now we are in times of financial struggles and rampant unemployment, and senior citizens like myself, who rely only on a frozen monthly Social Security check, find it unconscionable for municipal workers to demand annual pay increases, and continuing golden benefits and pensions. This Common Council had the intelligence to try to cut spending by creating a hiring freeze, an end to the continuous insanity and growing animosity between the taxpayers and the well-off municipal employees. But that hiring freeze was lifted several times already this year. For those of you with any compassion and empathy, I think you can see why the struggling taxpayers are so infuriated. Well, tomorrow is election day, our day. The taxpayers' opportunity to voice their thoughts, opinions, and dissatisfaction with the unfairness in today's world. Remember, it is not only homeowners that are affected by ever-increasing taxes. Everyone of voting age is affected by the way money is spent by this Common Council, the department heads, and our mayor. If you are a renter, increases in government spending result in higher property taxes for your landlord, who will undoubtedly pass those tax increases on to you in the form of higher rent. I attended three of the six listening sessions, and all I learned was that this new city finance director uses the same kind of accounting methods that we see in Madison and Washington. It's impossible to follow their numbers and logic, makes no sense to the common person, and results in the same bulging debt that must be made up by the unaware taxpayers. The numbers presented by the Greater Sheboygan Committee were clear, concise, and presented in a way that the taxpayers and citizens could understand. With all the businesses that moved out of Sheboygan recently, and with all the vacant, foreclosed, and listed houses for sale, property values have dropped dramatically, making for a much lower tax base that now has to come up with the same or more money to carry on the services enjoyed in the past. So don't be fooled. Something has to be given up in order to control spending. At the election polls tomorrow, we have a great opportunity to lighten the taxpayers' load by putting the ambulance service where it belongs, back in the private sector, where we were.
We cannot speak of the vote tomorrow. That's campaigning. I said the same thing to the other gentleman up here.
Okay.
Doing so.
A city the physical size and population of Sheboygan does not require 73 firefighters, a number that can be reduced by eliminating the ambulance service. No one has ever disputed the fact that we have very competent, professional firefighters, and a reduction in their number will not result in having to pay unemployment to them. The city obtained many of our firefighter paramedics from Orange Cross when the city took away that private sector contract. And as Chief Herman already indicated, the positions eliminated will undoubtedly result in those employees being rehired by the private sector ambulance contractor.
Excuse me, Pat, would you like your additional minute?
Nope, I'm finished.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pat. That is all for public forum. Vice President Rindflesh.
Thank you, Your Honor. One of the other rules that was not discussed prior to on the rules of the council is that the we don't really allow for personal attacks of city officials. And I think some comments probably crossed the line between politics and personal attacks, specifically regarding the Schenck audits and attacks on the abilities and intent, perhaps, of our finance director, James Amodio. As well as Chief Herman was mentioned as complicit in something. And I would like the opportunity, while unusual, for those people to respond to the issue. I know, and specifically with the Schenck audit, we did receive an email this week from the city attorney's office. And we did discuss in finance, I think it's appropriate that that information be passed on to the public as well for those. If it hadn't been really, I think, a personal attack, I think I would have no say in this, but my recommendation is that we allow those people to respond because they were attacked. Thank you.
Is your motion to open the floor to
yes.
those two? I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second to open the floor to both Finance Director Jim Amodio and Chief Herman from the Fire Department.
City Attorney as well, in terms of the Schenck audit, if that's all right. Do you have any comments regarding that as well?
I don't have any comments regarding
okay.
the Schenck audit.
We'll have a motion to open the floor to Director Amodio and a second. All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. The floor is open if you'd like to speak, Mr. Amodio.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the council, and city residents. I'd like to start by saying financial statements for all entities, public or private, are presented in summary form. Using this data that on the surface supports your cause is very misleading, and unless you understand the detail, it is very difficult to present a fair and representation of what the numbers really say. I assume that is a reason why the Greater Sheboygan Committee never asked to meet and discuss details with me after our initial meeting on September 9th before the listening sessions. Throughout all of the listening sessions, the city presented financial numbers from 2008 and 9 actuals, 2010 projected, and 2011 budgeted. Not once did my office receive a call to discuss any of these by the Greater Committee. Instead, they used data that was misleading. In 2007, they ignored the fact that the city leased 3 ambulances, even though the summary financials on our website showed that. But the committee stated that the ambulance did not include $551,000 as an expense, when in fact it was not. The real net expense in 2007 was $16,000. In the latest email I received regarding revenues and expenses from Faye Rayner that was also sent to the Sheboygan Press, stated in 2008 it showed more revenue than the city reported. The city showed $630,000 of revenue in 2008, and in Faye's analysis, she showed $737,000 of revenue. I shouldn't even bring this up, as it is in the city's favor. However, it is not a correct number. Summary financials on the city's website show adjustments to this revenue number, and the city has stated the cash it collected for that year was $630,000. In 2009, summary financials showed a loss of $86,651. Without understanding the detail on the surface, this would be correct. However, the ambulance fund was charged with an expense of $341,150 that was transferred to the general fund as revenue. In 2010, actual cost-to-date information was used by the Greater Sheboygan Committee to project a contribution of $111,000 that was positive based on 10.5 months of actual and forecasting the remaining of the year. This report of actual costs or cost-to-date was distributed at the Finance Committee meeting on, October 13th, 2010, stating that the report was dated October 15th, but that the actual cost was through September 30th. This report was also emailed to all other alderpersons on October 15th as well. The projections by the city were a contribution of $259,000 for 2010 projected. Greater Sheboygan Committee, by using 10.5 months of actual and estimating the balance, understated revenue. If the data were through October 15th, they should have used 9.5 months, not 10.5 months. In addition, the ambulance lease was added in a second time, thus overstating expenses for that year as well. The 2007 through 2009 plus the 2010 estimate from Faye Rayner states that this ambulance service lost $201,599. Based on the above, the city's numbers show a benefit to the city of $707,291. The difference between these two numbers is $909,000 of understated revenue and overstated costs. And this is what the committee wants you, the taxpayer, to believe. I have been a finance professional for 40 years, and I stand by the numbers I have presented to be factual and not misleading. As we all know, you can take numbers to a certain point and make them support your opinion. However, finance professionals, including CPAs, have a moral obligation to tell the truth and find out all the relevant facts, more times than not, often buried in the detail, before they express their professional opinion. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Amodio. We also have a motion to open the floor to...
Chief Herman.
Chief Herman.
That wasn't my part of my original motion.
It was part of the motion.
Anybody opposed to the floor being open to Chief Herman?
We already voted on that last time.
They're directors. They don't need it.
Well, it's kind of the timing of it is odd, to say the least. Chief.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. I appreciate the opportunity to respond. However, I think everybody's just about heard enough on this subject in the last few months. Finally, tomorrow, we're going to come to a conclusion, and I will limit my comments to what I had prepared to say to you originally. I couldn't help but notice on tonight's agenda that there was a communication to reorganize the fire department based on the Manitowoc Fire Department. Now, it seems to me for the past couple of months, all I've heard is we were wrong in comparing ourselves to Manitowoc Fire Ambulance Service, and we should be more like West Bend. I have heard aldermen and citizens throw around the names of cities like Maple Grove, Eden Prairie, Bloomington, Des Moines, and Oak Creek as comparables. During the listening sessions, the Greater Sheboygan Committee continually asked me, why couldn't we be more like the City of La Crosse Fire Department? Coincidentally, on Friday of last week, I received a call from a reporter from La Crosse. It seems that they have a few citizens and aldermen in La Crosse that are questioning why La Crosse Fire Department can't be more like Sheboygan. Are you following that circle here that we're going in? One thing is certain. Tomorrow, the voters will go to the polls and decide the future of the ambulance service. This decision will have an impact on both the short and long-range plan of the fire department. Together, we must move forward with an acceptable plan for public protection and safety. This council must now deal with the ramifications of that vote. You must give me a clear and concise indication of the level of service you expect us to provide. My firefighters know exactly what I expect of them. I expect them to strive for zero fire fatalities through effective public education programs, fire inspections, fast response times, and well-executed search and rescue techniques. I expect them to contain every fire to either the room of origin or the structure involved and to do it safely. I expect them to handle each and every call for assistance completely and professionally. I ask you, what are your expectations? What outcomes do you look for from your fire department? Are they the same expectations as mine? The public made it very clear this past summer they do not like the idea of closing fire stations and reducing response times. Our challenge is to meet the public expectations, yet in a fiscally responsible manner. The decisions are tough, but they must be made before an effective plan can be drawn up and implemented. First and foremost, these decisions must be based on expected outcomes and the level of service our citizens have come to expect from their fire department. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Alderman Versey.
Nope, you answer it.
Nothing. Okay, I thank both everybody from Public Forum, Director Jim Amodio and Chief Herman. Under Mayor's announcements, I have a couple different items here. First of all, Sue has something to say regarding voting tomorrow on her staff.
Right. It's very brief, but I just wanted the public to know and all of you to know. We are expecting a record turnout tomorrow. We're planning as if it were a presidential election. So for the city of Sheboygan, I'm predicting about 65%, which is huge. The reason I wanted to say something quickly is my office has been hit with a couple of very severe medical issues. Two of us have had some very serious problems with husbands and are ongoing, and I've got a staff that is trying to hold on here, and I just need to acknowledge them because they are breaking their backs trying to get through this election without myself and somebody else that's also dealing with her husband. So if you see them at the polls when they're delivering, or if you see them in the hallway, please tell them thank you, because we would not have an election without them. That would be Linda, everybody knows Linda Long, and Cheryl Smith, and Barb Ulm, and Cinda Langhoff. So they are really, they've stepped up to the plate for me and for one of the gals. So I just want to
think Linda's blushing back there.
I see her holding her back. She's sore.
That says a lot for the dedication of your staff, Sue. Thank you. Just a couple quick announcements here. The budget hearing will be November 15th, which is 2 weeks from today. I know some people were asking about that. The budget hearing will be on the 15th at 7 p.m., which is our regular council meeting. And on Monday, the 22nd, the budget will be voted upon. Monday, the 22nd at 7 p.m. in the council chambers, just so everybody has that on their schedule. Other announcements, I do not have a lot here. I would like to comment a bit on the happenings in the city over the last couple of months. And mainly what I would like to speak on is on the behalf of our finance department. We've had a lot of people that have come forward and have outright declared the honesty of our finance department, of our finance director, of our deputy finance director, and as our department as a whole. I'm here to say tonight that I unequivocally stand 100% behind our finance department, behind Jim Amodio, our finance director, and behind his figures. These people are professionals. This is what they do for a living. This is their livelihood. This is their life. To insinuate that our finance department is run like a JC's bingo game in Sheboygan Falls is degrading to say the least. I stand behind our figures. Whether the referendum on the ambulance goes one way or the other, I stand behind our finance department, and I want that to be known. That's all I have. Thank you. Alderman Hammond?
Mr. Mayor, could you maybe announce where the budget hearing is going to be on the 15th?
That will be in the council chamber. I thought I had mentioned that.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you, Alderman Hammond. Okay, moving on. We have a hearing this evening. This is a hearing regarding the proposed issuance by the City of revenue bonds in one or more series pursuant to Section 66.1103 of the Wisconsin statutes as amended in a maximum aggregate principal amount not in excess of $6 million on behalf of RCS Empowers Incorporated. Is there anybody that would like to be here? To be heard. For a second time, is there anybody that would like to be heard? Alderman Hanna?
Yeah, just a brief comment. This is a hot topic in the Wall Street Journal of communities that abuse this, and we follow the rules. So I'd like to commend the chair of the Finance Committee. This is how you're supposed to be using the revenue bonds and promoting the city and doing good things. Some communities have stretched the rules. There's one in Florida in particular, so I'm real proud of the way we handle it.
Thank you, Alderman Hanna. For a third time, is there anybody that would like to be heard? President Kittleson?
Thank you, Mayor. I would ask that the hearing be closed.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to close the hearing. Under discussion? If there is no discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The hearing is closed. Consent agenda. It's a little mixed up this evening.
It comes from a mixed up clerk's office. What can I say?
Mixed up busy clerk's office tonight, so bear with me. Okay, we have 15-1 through 15-15, plus 15-17, and 15-30. Alderperson. President Kittleson.
Thank you, Mayor. I move that all ROs be accepted and placed on file, all RCs be accepted and adopted, and all resolutions and ordinances be passed.
Second.
We have a motion and a second under discussion. Alderman. Oh, I Thought somebody buzzed in. Under discussion. If there is no discussion, roll call, please.
Okay. Hannah.
Aye.
Hannah.
Aye.
Heidemann.
Aye.
Koth.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Rindfleisch.
Aye.
Raessler.
Aye.
Sampson.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Versey.
Aye.
Boren.
Aye.
Bauck.
Aye.
Bowers.
Aye.
And Decker.
Aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. Reports of officers 2, 15, 16, and 15, 19 lie over until November 22nd. 15, 18, and 15, 20 through 15, 29 to be referred. Alderman Bowers?
Yes, thank you.
Do you have a question?
Yes, I would like 15, 23 to be referred to the Finance Committee and Committee of the Whole in addition to the Public Protection and Safety.
Okay, 1523, by the City Clerk submitting a communication from Alderman Bowers regarding a reorganization of the Sheboygan Fire Department based on Manitowoc's Fire Department. You want that to go, it's going to PP&S right now, you want that to go to Committee of the Whole?
Yes, and the Finance.
And the Finance Committee?
Yes.
Okay. We have another light. Alderperson Montemayor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. On agenda item 1524, I think that's already been handled, so I would make a motion to file.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to file 1524. Under discussion, Alder President Kittleson.
Thank you, Mayor. Can we take 1547 right along with that?
Yes, 47 is with 24, 40, 24 being the communication from Maynard Sonneman regarding his opinion on the finance director's alleged delay in supplying information to the Greater Sheboygan Committee and Faye Urainer. 1547 is the RO regarding the emails. Under discussion.
And thank you, Mayor. And the 1547 being the reply from our city attorney.
Yes.
I think the aldermen have had a chance to read through that, and I think it's been taken care of.
Okay, and our city attorney did spend 2 days doing an internal investigation. All of the aldermen have been supplied with his response. Is there any discussion on filing of 1547?
And 24.
All in favor of filing 1524 and 47, say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. They are filed. Going back to, we do have 1523 by Alderman Bowers, also going to Committee of the Whole and Finance.
We can just do that if you want. We don't need a motion.
Yes, we don't need a motion on that. That will go to Committee of the Whole and Finance. So 18 and 20 through 29, less 24, to be referred. How's that? Okay, resolutions introduced 3, 1531. Lies over. 1532 and 33 lie over until November 22nd. Those are budget issues. 1534 through 1538, to be referred. Report of Committee 6, 1539, lies over to November 22nd. Report of Committee 7 lies over 1540 and 1541 lies over to November 22nd. Now we finally have something to do here. 1542. Okay, report of Committee 7, 1542, by salaries and grievances recommending filing documents relating to the city administrator. Alderman Hannah.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is kind of what happens when there's multiple referrals. We had this document in. I would like to make a motion that the report of committee be accepted and adopted.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Please continue.
Yeah, it's kind of what happens when there's multiple referrals. there would be a financial impact, and this requires a Fife form, and we don't have the Fife data in salary and grievances, so we put it on hold, came forward. The document's still active in finance.
He was
held.
Held in finance.
Held in finance, correct.
But it gets complicated when there's multiple.
Alderman Rindfleisch.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Vice President Rindfleisch.
I agree to streamline and clear it up. I'm in general opposed to multiple referrals because of this problem. Just a clarification, though, while it's in hold in finance, the document would be dead. Is that correct, Attorney McLean, here, if we vote on this?
Can't vote on it. There's no fight.
I believe so.
Right. Okay. So, based on that, since we've decided to hold it in finance, while there's no Fife, there is no money at this point in time. We decided that the 2 years of the committee work didn't want to kill at this point in time, which would be, you know, dead. Yes, it can be brought back at a later date, but I'd rather keep it under discussion. And voting to accept this will kill that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Alderman Bouk.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I would urge my colleagues to vote no on this as well for the very same reason. I find it inappropriate for us to kill this document after 2 years of work on this. The discussion we had in the Finance Committee was, no, we probably can't afford a city administrator at this point. Mayor's going to be mayor for another 2 years, no matter what we do tonight. Mm-hmm. And all the good learning from this committee could be applied over the next 2 years so that if we as a body of 16 think that this is the right thing to do, we can tee it up so the trigger is pulled at the time when the next mayoral election happens. So I think it's completely inappropriate for us to flush 2 years worth of the committee's work down the toilet and kill it and make us resurrect it again just because we don't have the foresight to say we can't afford this role right now, but that doesn't mean we shouldn't keep all the learning and move ourselves toward that structure if you think the structure is the right thing to do. So I'm going to vote no on this because I think the right thing to do is to keep the dialogue going, and that's what we talked about in finance. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Alderman Bouk. Alderman Boren.
Thank you, Mayor Ryan. I've got a question for Attorney McLean. Attorney McLean, regarding setting the salary for the mayor's, when the mayor runs again in 14? 13? 13. When does the council set that salary for the mayor's next term? And I guess another way to ask that is, when would the council have to make a decision on whether the mayor's job remains a full-time job or goes to a part-time job, and then, of course, determining what the salary and the duties would be? Thank you.
I believe by ordinance, you're to set the elected officials, full-time elected official salaries, 13 months before the start of the term. That would be sometime in April of 2012.
Thank you.
Okay, so the motion on the floor is to
accept and adopt the report of committee.
Right, accept and adopt the report of
which
committee.
Which will file these documents.
Right.
To file it.
Right, the committee recommended that the documents be placed on file. So that is the motion and the second.
Just to clarify, Mr. Mayor, so a yes vote
will be to file these documents.
We'll file these documents.
Yep.
It is still in finance. Yep.
Thank you.
No.
It is. It's been held in finance.
It's still in finance. But
this it's still in finance.
But this would kill it.
This would kill that then as well. Mm. Right.
Yep. Clarification. These are
I could. Okay. Now, this is the issue you have with dual referrals. If you want to keep the issue of this resolution regarding establishing the position of city administrator for the city alive, I'd recommend not filing it. Because basically what you're saying, if the council approves filing it, you're filing that resolution. And once the resolution's filed, it's dead. And that's whether it's another copy of the same resolution, you'd have to bring in another resolution to start the process again.
So the committee recommended to file this document, but didn't mean to file it. Alderman Hanna.
I have a question for the Finance Committee. Are they, how close are they to having data together for a fife form?
We looked at various things. There is money there. We just maybe have some disagreement on whether the timing of it is proper to use it now, given our budget constraints. So that's probably the long and the short of it, without going into too much detail. So, but that's I don't know. Anybody else in the finance wants to chime in? I think it's there, but others may not.
Alderman Boren.
Thank you, Mayor Ryan. I've got a question for City Clerk Richards. Sue, if we keep this alive in finance, that would only keep this document alive until the end of this council year. So finance would have to do something if they want to on this document before April. Is that correct?
Correct. If they want to, they can do one of two things. They can act on it before the end of the council year, or they can tell me that they're going to refer it on to the new council.
Okay, so this is not indefinite by keeping it alive. The finance would have to do something with it, either file it or move ahead with this.
Right. If they do
April.
Nothing with it, it dies in committee.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Alderman Bauck, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I was just going to add to what Chairman Hammond said. Also, Alderman Hanna, we had a long night of conversation about the budget. We're in the middle of budget, and I think we just prioritized that budget conversations needed to happen first, knowing that once the budget was done, we could come back to that, because as Alderman Boren pointed out, we've got until winter of 2012 to figure it out. So I think we were having important conversations about the budget and realized that could take second fiddle, especially given that if the money isn't there, it was really about keeping the content alive as well. And I think it would be easy and benign for us to refer it to the next Finance Committee. I don't think that's a difficult thing. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Alderman Bob. Alderperson Montemayor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Having been here a little while, we've had a lot of studies that have been done, especially regarding the building of the police station. And no matter how they were filed, we referred to them from the studies from 1996, and also we referred to the studies with the Remuneration Committee, even though that had been filed. None of it went away simply because it was filed. Those lengthy studies were referred to times after they were filed.
I think that's why they call it to be placed on file. Yeah. Alderman Rindfleisch.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Alderperson Montemayor.
I didn't mean to create a little firestorm or debate today, but I guess I'll respectfully disagree. Well, with Alderman Montemayor, the documents, you know, it's history, it's in file somewhere, we can bring it to it. But the action to file states that we as a council suggest and go on record saying the item should be filed, should be put away. And that's what I'm not willing to go on record to say, is that, you know, it should be filed and put away. I feel strongly in the long-term plan, this makes sense for the city. In the short-term plan, it doesn't work in the budget right now. But I do refer back to the 2 years of the committee to meet and discuss this. Furthermore, I think we as a city need to take a long-range view. Perhaps it doesn't work for us in the long range. Perhaps, you know, a different system or a current system is most ideal for the city. But big decisions like that need to be thought out and not rushed. And you know, on one hand, by voting to file it, we're rushing that. We're saying, no, not right now. Bring it back at some date in the future. But when? When is that? You know, we have some momentum going on this item. I'd like to keep that momentum going and just urge you just to vote no right now, to not file it, and allow the Finance Committee to do its work in the future and see if it's possible or not. That's all I ask. Thank you.
Thank you, Alderman Rindfleisch. Alderman Heideman.
Thank you, Mayor. I would be doing a disservice to my fellow committee members that I spent not only 1 year with, but 2 years with, looking at city administrator, trying to bring it in front of this common council, only to have it die all the time and the conversation goes away. Again, I will be voting no, because again, though you like to say we get things referred again, I'll agree with Alderman Rindfleisch. Once they're filed, they don't have much of a chance of coming back.
Thank you, Alderman Heideman.
Thank you.
Is there any further discussion? Okay, what is the motion on the floor?
The motion on the floor was to that the report of committee be accepted and adopted.
Accepted and adopted, which means a yes vote will file it, a no vote will not. Everybody clear on that? Roll call, please.
Okay. Hannah?
Yes.
Heidemann? Koth?
No.
Kittleson?
Aye.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Rindfleisch?
No.
Raessler?
Yes.
Sampson?
Yes.
Vanderweel?
No.
Versey?
Yes.
Boren?
Aye.
Bauck?
No.
Bowers?
No.
Decker?
Aye.
And Hammond?
No.
Eight ayes, seven noes.
Motion carries. Reports of committees 9. 1543 by Public Works recommending repealing and recreating section 74-63 of the municipal code entitled fire control so as to allow with restrictions fires within designated fire rings in city parks and city owned property. President Alderman Boren, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mayor Ryan. I move that the report of the committee be put upon its passage, and we also need a general ordinance passage on that also.
Yep.
Second.
Yes, accept and adopt and put the ordinance upon its passage.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alderman Boren. We have a motion and a second under discussion. There is no discussion. Roll call, please.
Heidemann?
Aye.
Koth?
Aye.
Kittleson?
Aye.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Rindfleisch?
Aye.
Raessler?
Aye.
Sampson?
Aye.
Vanderweel?
Aye.
Versey?
Aye.
Boren?
Aye.
Bauck?
Aye.
Bowers?
Aye.
Decker?
Aye.
Hammond?
Aye.
And Hannah?
Aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. Ordinances introduced 10, 1544, and 1545 to be referred. Matters laid over 11, 1532. Resolution number 121-10-11 by Alderpersons Hammond, Rindfleisch, Boren, and Raessler. Authorizing entering into an agreement with Grafe to provide neighborhood revitalization efforts consulting services. Alderman Hammond.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I move that the resolution be put upon its passage.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to put the resolution upon its passage under discussion. If there is none, roll call, please.
Koth?
Aye.
Kittleson?
Aye.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Rindfleisch?
Aye.
Raessler?
Aye.
Aye.
Vanderweel?
Aye.
Versey?
Abstain.
Boren?
Aye.
Bauck?
Aye.
Bowers?
Aye.
Decker?
Aye.
Hammond?
Aye.
Hannah?
Aye.
And Heidemann?
Aye.
14 ayes, one abstention.
Motion carries. 14-34, RC number 242-10-11 by Public Works relative to authorizing the appropriate city officials to execute the dock space agreement between the city and Windsor for berthing of the X cannon in the Sheboygan River. Public Works. Alderman Boren.
Thank you, Mayor Ryan. I move that the report of committee be put upon its passage.
Second.
And also the resolution.
Report of committee be accepted and adopted. Resolution be put upon its passage.
Thank you.
Motion in a second.
Under discussion, we just received an updated agreement with WINSA tonight, and I was wondering if Attorney McLean would mind just going over a couple of the highlights from that new agreement. Thank you.
Thank you, Alderman Boren.
Sure, Alderman Boren. The changes that are being reported out from the Public Works Committee, there's really three. The original draft talked about annual rent of $1, and that was just put in as a placeholder, basically, until there's some discussion about rent. But the Public Works Committee has recommended in the agreement before you is $2,500 a year that would have an inflation factor for future years. And the way it's been structured for quite a while is the rent kicks in the beginning of the second calendar year of operation once the X cannon is in Sheboygan in place and open for the public. So there's no rent the first year. Basically, it's for the WINSA group to get their feet on the ground, generate some revenue, and then the rent would start the second year. Secondly, there was an additional contingency added to the original agreement to require submittal by WNSA of documentation prepared by the engineering firm, concluding that the docking of the cannon won't have any detrimental impact upon the stormwater outfall that's immediately at the vicinity of the docking space. There's a 42-inch storm sewer outfall, and that the engineering consulting firm would also establish that there would be no detrimental impact upon the vessel itself as well. Then there's one clarification or expansion of one of the other contingencies, and that deals with there was language in the agreement about as a contingency before the cannon could be located along the river there, just upstream from the Highland House, that the be prior completion of the PCB remediation operations that's part of the Sheboygan River and Harbor Superfund project and related dredging. And what was added was, just to clarify, so as to provide a navigable channel adjacent to the waters to be occupied by the X-cannon. And the rationale for that came up when the yacht club raised concerns about their boat lifting facility just upriver from where the cannon is. They've got some boat storage space there, and they haul boats out of the water, and they wanted to make sure, and I believe they're comfortable with the cannon being located where it's proposed to be located, as long as they're assured that there is a navigable channel just offshore from the cannon. So that was inserted in there. Other than that, the language has been, it's the same as what was originally introduced a number of months ago.
Thank you, Attorney McLean. Under discussion, Alderman Bourne.
Thank you, Mayor Ryan. I saw Ms. Sharpakniak in the audience tonight from WNSA, and I was wondering if she would like to give the council an update on where WNSA stands with bringing the X-cannon to Sheboygan, if we could open up the floor to her.
Second.
We have a motion and second to open the floor to Ms. Pakniak. All in favor say
aye. Aye.
Opposed? Char, the floor is open.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. Just an update for everybody. We have completed all of our application for phase two to the Navy. They have asked for some additional information, which we have prepared and are sending off to them. And we are proceeding fundraising and everything needed to bring the ship here. And the understanding that we will work with the timetable at this point will be that the ship will arrive in fall of 2012 once the dredging is completed. So we're very excited. We're getting very positive feedback from the community and from the citizens. They're really excited about the ship coming.
Thank you, Char. Are there any questions for Ms. Pakniak? Alderman Bowers, did you have anything? Thank you, Char. Any further discussion? Alderman Bourne?
Thank you, Mayor. Just that we could, if we could take 1440 along with it, it's kind of a companion document. Can we take that?
I would just file 1440 because it's just a duplicate.
Okay.
Okay, so we're at 1434.
Still done. And filing 1440?
Mm-hmm.
I'll make a motion to file
1440.
Motion to file 1440 along with it. Mm-hmm. Okay, which is next? Okay. Sharp touched on a bit the river dredging, which hasn't come up in a while. Again, the river is, we have another meeting on it tomorrow. The river is dredging is set to start in April. The dewatering site is built. It will be a two-summer project, so by the end of 2012, when the cannon is scheduled to arrive, the river should be dredged, that we have no problem with navigation. So, okay. We have a motion to accept and adopt and put the resolution upon its passage and to file 1440. Any further discussion? If there is none, roll call, please.
Kittleson?
Aye.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Rindfleisch?
Aye.
Raessler?
Aye.
Sampson?
Aye.
Vanderweel?
Aye.
Versey?
Aye.
Boren?
Aye.
Bauk?
Aye.
Bowers?
Aye.
Decker?
Aye.
Hammond?
Aye.
Hanna?
Aye.
Heidemann?
Aye.
And Koth?
Aye.
15 ayes.
Motion carries. 1444, General Ordinance Number 34-10-11 by Alderpersons Hannah, Kittleson, Raessler, Vanderweel, and Versey, amending the Municipal Code so as to delete and add various positions to the table of organization in the Finance Department for the City of Sheboygan. Alderman Hannah.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I would make a motion that the General Ordinance be put upon its passage.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to put the general ordinance upon its passage under discussion. There is none. Roll call, please.
Montemayor?
Aye.
Rindfleisch?
Aye.
Raessler?
Aye.
Sampson?
Aye.
Vanderweel?
Aye.
Versey?
Aye.
Boren?
Aye.
Bauk?
Aye.
Bowers? Bowers?
Aye.
Decker?
Aye.
Hammond?
Aye.
Hanna?
Aye.
Heidemann?
Aye.
Koth?
Aye.
And Kittleson?
Aye.
Thank you, Alderman Belt. 15 ayes.
Motion carries. Other matters authorized by law, 1546 will be referred to Public Protection and Safety, and 1547 will be referred to Salaries and Grievances. Other matters authorized by law, Attorney McLean?
We filed 1547.
We filed 1547. Thank you, Alderman Hammond. Attorney McLean.
1548 is an RO by the city clerk submitting various license applications for the period ending June 30, 2011 and June 30, 2012.
That will be referred to Public Protection and Safety.
1549 is a resolution authorizing renewing the agreement for Human Resources and Labor Relations Consulting Services with HR Unlimited LLC for the period January 1, 2011 through December 31, 2011.
Okay, let me back up. The first one will be referred to Law and Licensing. 1548, 1549 will be referred to Salary and Grievances.
1550 is an RO by the city clerk submitting the LTC certification for the tax levy report that supports the 2010-11 budget for Lakeshore Technical College District.
That will lie over till November 22nd.
1551 is an RO by the city clerk submitting the Sheboygan Area School District tax levy certification for the 2010-11 school year.
Will also lie over till November 22nd.
1552 is an RO by the city clerk submitting the Wisconsin Department of Public Instruction tax levy certification from the Kohler School District for the 2010-2011 school year.
Also lies over till the 22nd.
1553 is an RO by the city clerk submitting a claim from Tamara Adamson for alleged damages to her door when police officers pounded on her door looking for someone.
Will be referred to risk management. That is all.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
We have a motion to adjourn in a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We are adjourned. Thank you. Good work.